I'm just going to jump right into it today because I got a lot of scripture that I want to cover. And I'm real excited about this message. I'm as excited about this message as any message that I've ever given. And so you guys just sit back. We're going to cover a good bit of scripture. If you've got your Bibles, get them out and read them with me. And we're just going to cover a lot of scripture. We're going to talk about this idea. Last month we had talked about that following Christ is a life response. When you accept His grace and His mercy, that a genuine outpouring and outcropping of that decision and that relationship is that you give Him your life in response to taking His life to cover your sin, and that's what the relationship is. So we're gonna go a lot further with that this week. We're starting on the foundation. I'm gonna talk to you guys about some stuff in the Old Testament, reading through that again, and then seeing some amazing things that connect with the New Testament, being on the heels of reading that. So I think it'll be a fun, intense, strong, uplifting message that'll make you want to follow harder and give more and just yield more. So that's where we're going at today, and we're gonna start here. I ran across this quote, and I wanted to lead with this quote right here and let this sink in throughout the whole message. I want you guys to kind of turn back to this, think of this. If you only kind of remember a couple things out of the message, remember this. It's a thought kind of for the day, so meditate on this. Turn your face towards the sun, and the shadows fall behind you. It's turn your face towards the sun, and I've changed that to S-O-N. Turn your face towards the sun, and the shadows fall behind you. And I want you to go outside today in the sun and do that. Me and Daniel did it yesterday. I said that quote, and it's just stand out in the sun and look where the shadows are if your face is towards it. That's why he said to fix your eyes on Jesus, as he's the author and perfecter of your faith. So what we're going to talk about is this. As Tanya and I are reading the Old Testament into the New again, and on the heels of the New, she saw something that I didn't see, and we were reading through there. She said, hey, have you seen how many times that it says, here I am, that these guys answer, here I am, when we were starting to read that? And I said, well, I noticed it, but I didn't notice it as strongly as you did. And so I went back and started studying it, and when I did, I was just dumbfounded by the strength of that attitude, by the fact that is the attitude that Christ builds his renewed relationship on from Abraham, and then of course when Christ comes and dies for our sin and reestablishes that torn relationship. But as the relationship got severed from Adam and Eve, and then he's calling out to man again to try and reestablish a relationship and show us what it's like to interact with God, and he does that through Abraham, and that's where we first see this here I am statement, this attitude. Here I am represents a servant's attitude. It's saying, I mean, my life is yours. It's what Richard had said and alluded to. It's a living sacrifice, and that's given him your life for taking his life. So I want to jump into the scripture and just get into that. First, I wanted to point out that belief in a promise and your response to that belief that you have in his promise, that's the beginning of a relationship. And then after you believe it, there's going to be a test to see if you really believe it. And the definition of a test is the means by which the presence, quality, or genuineness of anything is determined. That's the means by which the presence, quality, or genuineness of anything is determined. That's what a test is. I want to read it one more time because it's so strong. I mean, that's what a lot of the things we go through are this, and it's like fire refining our faith, and we end up wandering off instead of passing the test. So test is the means by which the presence, quality, or genuineness of anything is determined. A means of a trial. So I want to jump right in and read Genesis 22. And I want you guys to read along with me. I may not even get to the other part of this scripture I wanted to cut, but this right here, it's so strong. Let's just jump into it together at Genesis 22. said sometime later, God tested Abraham. And this was after he had already made him a promise, okay? He had come to him and made him a promise that he would have a child and that he would build a nation of people that followed him through his offspring. Well, at the time, he's 100 years old. His wife is 90. They're both barren. But it said that Abraham believed. Abraham believed at the time, and it was credited to him as righteousness. So he believed the promise, even though, and you have to look at it too, he even laughed when he said it out loud. He's like, how can this be? But he still believed it. So now he's believed that the son has been born. It's his only son, and now comes the testing of this belief. Sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham, here I am, he replied. And I want to point out that he only has to call him one time. Everybody else that has this response, there's two. It's Abraham. Here, to start this relationship, Abraham's so in tune that it only takes one time, and he says, here I am, he replied. Then God said, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I'll tell you about. Early the next morning, that kind of blew me away in and of itself. Early the next morning, he didn't spend any time trying to talk out of this, trying to get out of it. He just accepted what the Lord said. He knew that it was, and here we go. Early the next morning, Abraham got up, saddled his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place that God had told him about. I want to stop just for one second there and take that in. The other day I was out cutting wood after I had read, was studying this, and I was thinking about every piece of wood that I'm cutting is bringing life to me and my wife. It's bringing us heat. I look at it like that, so it's a joy to get it because it's something good. Abraham was looking at this while he was cutting wood. Imagine what he's thinking. He's thinking every piece of wood that he's cutting is going to kill his son. Okay, I started thinking about that in the terms of God, because that's the parallel that you're going to see here is Abraham and God. I started thinking, what was God thinking when he's cutting wood? What is God cutting wood? And it just kind of hit me. The Old Testament is God cutting wood. It's him cutting wood, and everything throughout the Old Testament, he knows this is going to end up killing my son. Okay? It just had hit me. I thought it was pretty powerful. So he cut enough wood for the burnt offering. He set out for the place that God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship, and then we'll come back to you. Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. Okay, first I want us to stop at that and see the parallel with Christ at verse 6. Abraham took the wood. God took the wood, the cross, and he put it on his son. Okay, Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac. Okay, as the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father Abraham, Father, yes, my son, Abraham replied, the fire and the wood are here, Isaac said, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham answered, God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. I want us to hold on to that. When they reached to the place that God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. On top of the wood, isn't that what Christ did? Then he reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, Abraham, Abraham, here I am, he replied. Servant's attitude again, it's whatever you say, Lord, here I am to do your will. I thought it was powerful that it took the Lord two times there to get him to stop what he was doing. He's so into what he's doing, it only took him one time to hear it. That kind of stuff's just powerful to me. Do not lay a hand on the boy, he said, after Abraham said, here I am. He said, do not lay a hand on the boy, he said. Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God, because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son. See, it was a test. See, he's testing him to see if he's got the stuff that he wants to build this relationship on. God already had in mind that he was going to give his only son, that he was going to provide the lamb. He wanted to build this relationship with someone that felt the same way about him. That's here I am. See, I got something that's going to blow y'all away here at the end when we get to it. So he said, because you fear God and you haven't withheld. Okay, at verse 13, Abraham looked up, and there in the thicket he saw a ram. I thought that was poignant too, because it's not a lamb. The lamb is Christ that's coming. Okay, he's providing the lamb. This was a ram. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, the Lord will provide. And to this day it said, on the mountain of the Lord it will be provided. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make the descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me. Okay, what I see here is you see strongly the parallel of God and Abraham, what God's doing, how he's looking for the same heart that he has to establish this relationship. And I want you guys to look at these other verses. I don't have time to read these two other chunks of stuff that we were going to look at. I want to get into some other stuff. But I want y'all on your own to go and look at Genesis 31:11. 32:22. Read that story about Jacob on his own, because he says, here I am too. Then I want you to look at Moses at Exodus 3:1-14. And I'm not kidding about this. I'm not just saying, I want you to go back and read it. Go and look at it, because if you're interested in this, it's going to make it stronger. I just don't have time to get to all of that meat. So that's another here I am too, excuse me, where you see that these guys are giving their all for God's all. And that's what we had talked about last month, is if you take his grace and his mercy, that the natural byproduct, if you understand what that grace and mercy is you hand him back your life. And that's the here I am. Okay, so I want y'all to look at the Moses thing, because that's pretty powerful, and we see a parallel with the Holy Spirit in the burning bush, and we have that Holy Spirit now. But what I want y'all to also see at the end of that, and I'm just going to go at the last verse of that Exodus part. At verse 14, God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you're to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. Okay, and then what I saw in Revelation 3:20 was that Jesus says, here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in and eat with him, and he with me. So what I started to see here very strongly was, it's his all for your all. It's here, his here I am for your here I am. See, what I was trying to allude to in some talks yesterday was that Abraham had that willingness, right? He had the willingness to do whatever God said. And when God sees that humble heart, that willingness to obey, 9 times out of 10, a lot of times he said, well, don't do it then. I'll do it myself. I just wanted to see if you were willing. I wanted to test your heart. I wanted to see what was really in your heart, if you really were going to follow me. See, you don't know if something's genuine unless it's tested. You don't know the quality of a material until it's tested. So we have to go through these tests. And are we passing these tests? Are we yielding our hearts to him in this test and saying, here I am, even if it's something that looks like it's horrible in the world, or that it's going to destroy us? If we know that it's from him, from his word, that he's leading us, that we say, here I am, Lord. Because see, what you see is, as soon as you do that, even before you've already done that, he's standing at the door saying, here I am. Here I am. And I thought that was pretty interesting, because he had called himself I am. Jesus had called himself that. Here we see in the Old Testament, he's referring to himself as that. And then he's delineating the place where he is, right here. I am. Right? That's his name. He's here. See, he's in you if you've accepted him. Follow him. Say, here I am to do your will, no matter what it is. See, and then he's going to lead and guide you. I think it's pretty powerful when we look after this relationship had started with Abraham. It continues with Isaac and Jacob and then in Moses. Okay, Moses is carrying out the relationship that was started in the three generations of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. See, yesterday we had talked that Jacob was wrestling with God. See, we all wrestle with God sometimes in this period of testing. But he said that he wrestled with men and God but overcame. Well, that's back to a message we preached a long time ago about overcome and accepting his victory to overcome. And see, then he changed his name to Israel and continued to build that relationship. So the reason why I'm pointing this Old Testament stuff out is because it links to the new, the fulfillment of Christ. This is still the nuts and bolts of the relationship, okay, is the here I am. That was Christ's attitude. He came to the earth as a man, God, said, here I am, to pay the atonement for our sin. And he didn't want to do it. He said, let this cup pass from me, but not as I will, as you will. He was doing the here I am. And see, when you look at Deuteronomy 30:11, after Moses is telling me to follow this stuff, he says, now what I'm commanding you today is not too difficult for you or beyond your reach. It is not up in heaven so that you have to ask who will ascend into heaven to get it and proclaim it to us so that we may obey it. Nor is it beyond the sea so that you may have to ask who will cross the sea to get it and proclaim it to us so that we may obey it. No, the word is very near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart, so you may obey it. That's what Jesus said, to put it to practice. See, this was even in the Old Testament, but see, you see this heart condition rising throughout the legalism, even in the Old Testament. The word is very near you. It's in your mouth, in your heart, so you may obey it. In Deuteronomy 32:46, he says, take to heart all the words that I've solemnly declared to you this day. They are not just idle words for you. They are your life. Deuteronomy 30:20 said, love the Lord, listen to his voice, and hold fast to him, for the Lord is your life. I point those out because isn't that what Abraham did? Isn't that what the relationship is? You love the Lord, you listen to his voice, he calls on you, you respond with, here I am, you hold fast to him, and he's your life. There's nothing more. He's your life. He said, these words are your life. So the word became flesh. Then remember in Colossians, he tells us that Christ is your life. So we see the same theme, see, throughout thousands of years. Christ is your life. Okay? So then at Joshua 24:15, he said, but if serving, that's the here I am attitude, but if the here I am attitude seems, if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve. And he says later on, now then, said Joshua, throw away the foreign gods that are among you and yield your hearts to the Lord God of Israel. Yield your hearts. Yield your hearts. That's here I am. That's that Christ is your life, that you realize that you're dead, that your life is in him, that only being consumed in him. Remember when it said that the Lord is a consuming fire? See, but that's why I was going to point out in the bush, but it didn't burn up. See, that's what the Holy Spirit is in us. It's a consuming fire that it doesn't burn us up, but it consumes our life. Our life becomes his life. His goals become our goals. He's transforming us to his likeness ever so smallly as we follow him. And isn't that here I am attitude in the Old Testament that he built that relationship on? Isn't that the same thing that the disciples had? I mean, isn't that exactly what the disciples had? Where they it said that he called them and they left everything. I mean, said some of them was in the boat with their dad Zebedee. I mean, they left their nets, they left their dad, they left everything and followed him. I mean, really think about how strange that really is in the modern day terms. And yet still, that is exactly what he's calling us to do as disciples, to leave everything of the world and follow him. And then he gives us everything we need of the worldly things, the material things, the necessities, but you're not going after that anymore. I mean, it's like he said they were fishing for fish, and then he said you're going to be fishing for men. Well, they still ate, he still provided, but their focus wasn't on the fish. See, as Christians, our focus can't be on the fish. He's going to provide that too. But see, what if those guys would have stayed focused on the fish? And they'd have never gone after the men, and we wouldn't be where we're at now. I mean, it's not about the fish, guys. I mean, and that's the here I am attitude of saying, I know in the flesh it seems like my whole life's about getting these fish. But I believe in you. I believe that you created me, that you made me, that there's something deeper. There's something more to life than this material thing. And I feel a spirit in me that you made, and I want to relate with you. I want to hear your voice. I want you to hear mine. I want to talk with you. See, you see that clearly. Now we live in a world where it almost looks like you're crazy or something if you hear the voice of God. Everybody's supposed to hear his voice every day through his spirit and his truth, but we forsake his truth. We're not in the Bible. We don't know what it says. We're not listening to him, and that's where he speaks. Said the word became flesh. Okay? The word is him. He speaks to you through his word 9 times out of 10, but you have to open your heart up to get it, to hear it. So that's the here I am attitude is the relationship. And see, what you see, like I said last time, from the Isaiah 53 thing, if y'all go back and read Isaiah 53, you see that Isaiah 53 is the fulfillment of what God did to Christ, like Abraham was going to do to his son. And when we step up to the plate, then God takes the place for us and says, no, I've done it. I've overcome. I've done the victory. So just receive it through me. Humble yourself before me. And that's why I see every time is when we humble ourselves before God, humble ourselves down, he looks at us and has compassion on us. Says, no, come on up to the higher place. But whenever we're taking that higher place, he'll smash us down if he has to discipline us, to treat us, to get us back to what true happiness is. Because that never brings us true happiness. So that's the meat of this message. I wish I had time to go fully into it. Probably be a 2-hour message if you looked at all the stuff of Jacob and Moses and Exodus and all of those things. But what the deal is here, the main idea is you're accepting his grace and his mercy. You're accepting his here I am, and you're giving your all, your here I am. And it's his all for your all. And he said, you've got to lose your life to find it. See, that's the here I am. You give it to him, and then you're fulfilled in that fully as you follow him. But there's going to be tests, guys. And you've got to pass these tests. If you don't, that's considered turning away. If you go back to the worldly viewpoint and you don't pass that test, you're turning away from him and his truth when he's enlightened you. Or you never thought that you had to live with it to begin with. But either of those have the same result in the end. Okay? And I'm glad I got just a couple more minutes. I wanted to say one thing, that this is when you start giving him your heart in the here I am. The personal relationship becomes so strong, because so many people say, well, I don't know how that would even feel. Well, you have to take the nasty plunge to begin with, to seek him with all your heart, so then you can find him. And then you will hear his voice, but you've got to go all in. He doesn't, when you're playing Texas Hold'em, you go all in. If you hold one chip back, you don't get what he's giving you. You got to go all in, and then you get all of his kingdom resources and everything as you go and you follow him. But this is the kind of thing that he does, personal stuff, to let you know that he's in your life and that he's in control and that everything is okay as you follow him. You guys know that I'd still going through some back stuff. Yesterday I had brought about I wasn't even wanting to talk about it at all. Wasn't going to bring it up at all. Was not going to even talk about it. Daniel brought it up. We started talking about it just on a whim. One of the verses I hold to is Psalm 38. when I go through back injuries. So we talked about that. Psalm 38, I said it. Psalm 39, he's still kind of going through it. At Psalm 40, he starts to come out of it. Okay? And he's praising the Lord. He's got a new song in his mouth. So I got back home yesterday, was still going through it. So it's like, okay, I got to go back and read Psalm 40 again, see what I'm really trying to hang on to here. See, remind myself of the truth. Remind myself of, I said I remembered the beginning part of Psalm 40, but I didn't remember the end part or the middle part. So what does the whole thing say? I need to go back and read it myself. And I actually need to right now. I'll turn to it if I can find it. Okay, so I went back and I looked at it. And then I got to the middle part, and I almost started crying, guys, because at verse 6, he says, "Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but my ears you have opened. Burnt offerings and sin offerings you did not require. Then I said, here I am. I have come with the scroll written for me." That's the Bible. That right there may not mean anything to you. There's not a million instances of "here I am," guys, in the Bible. I didn't know about this one, I'm telling you. I didn't know about it. That was just his little thing to my heart that I know that maybe you don't believe it, but I do. I'm a statistician, okay? I mean, that's what psychology is built on. Statistically, that happening is like a tornado going through a junkyard and creating a 747, statistically, okay? And I've got even one bigger than that one for you now. Okay, so he gave me a peace in my heart that said, okay, this pain that you're going through, it's okay. Just hold on. All right? It's going to be okay, because Psalm 40 starts with, "I waited patiently." So see, when you give him your heart, there's going to be tests and times and tribulations. But you hold fast to his teaching. The words are your life. Christ is your life. You're consumed with it. There's nothing else. There's nothing else, guys. If you get caught up in the fish, you never go after the true meaning of life. They were called for a higher purpose. But remember, was fish ever an issue in Jesus' ministry? Did anyone ever go hungry? Did anyone ever need fish? No. They lacked nothing. The fish were always provided. He always provided. So you seek first his kingdom. You do what he's telling you to do. You obey him. You say, "Here I am." And then he takes care of everything else. So here's the real kicker, though, the one even bigger than the "here I am" in Psalm 40, because I know some people, well, I don't care about that. Well, I do. I mean, that meant a lot to me. Okay, he's saying there, sacrifice and offering, he's saying all of the outward stuff, that doesn't mean anything to me. I'm wanting your attitude. I'm wanting "here I am." I'm wanting your life. I'm wanting a living sacrifice. Okay? That's what he's saying. So then I get up this morning. All right, my back was feeling a little bit better yesterday. Get up this morning, trying to get up, and it gets wrenched again, trying to just get out of bed. I'm like, I don't even know if I can give this sermon. Okay, so then, the pain lifts. I'm like, okay, so I'll be able to do it. Just talking to God, telling him, "Whatever you want, here I am. If this is your will, whatever your will is in my life." Okay, get up, read my devotion. This devotion is a 365-day devotion. I've been using it for years. Okay, I'm like not even on the right day, today or whatever, because I'll just go. Sometimes if me and Tanya get on a whirl, we'll just read four or five of them at a time, or one, whatever. We don't follow the day. Get up today, and what is my devotion for today? Psalm 40, guys. Psalm 40. It's just him telling me I'm in control. Everything's okay. You're following me. You're trying. We're going somewhere. He's disciplining me, whatever he's doing. Okay, statistically, that is highly significant, what we would say in the psychology world. Okay, it's way significant. There's no way that it could be by chance. See, when you run statistical probabilities, numbers, you see if something could be by chance. You're looking at the science to see, based on these numbers, based on this, could this event happen by chance? That's what statistics is. I'm telling y'all, okay, the numbers on that, I mean, I know y'all don't need the numbers, a lot of you. I don't need the numbers. But for those of you who do, they're there. Okay? So that's the personal relationship. That's the here I am. That's the yielding your heart and the interplay of the relationship between you and Jesus. And you have to realize that God, He provided the sacrifice for the Lamb Himself by coming to the earth Himself in the form of His Son. And see, a lot of people struggle with the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, three in one. Do you struggle with yourself being mind, body, and spirit? You know that you're made of mind, body, and spirit, but you don't tear your hair apart about being three things in one body. Same way of Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And He Himself came to earth as the Lamb. And that's the take-home message. And I want to leave y'all with this one quote right here. Because it's what we started with, and I want to end on it. Because this is the whole deal. Turn your face towards the Son. The Son, S-O-N. Towards the Lamb. Turn your face towards the Son, and the shadows fall behind you.